Welcome. We're excited to have you here with us today. This year's return to teaching will be like nothing before because of what we've all been through this past year. And I'm sure you've already been thinking about what you're going to need to do to address those differences because we've all changed. Pepper is presenting 3 virtual sessions this summer to help you bring back the music. In June, we focused on getting your music school choir ready with teaching techniques and resources. We'll link to that below. But today, we'll be focusing on what music educators need to think about besides the music, on the social-emotional aspects of teaching and relating to your students on a deeper level. We're all going to need a new level of support this year, and with that in mind, we're calling this kind of approach Music Ed 2.0, because it truly is. If you need a certificate of participation for watching the video, please email me at events@jwpepper.com and tell me you watched the video. Tell me one thing you took away from the session and I'll get that right out to you. Okay, let's get to the reason we're all here. My guest today is Lesley Moffat. Lesley is currently the band director at Jackson High School in Everett, Washington, where she's taught since 2002. She's also the founder and CEO of the mPowered Music Educator Academy, where she runs Music Ed Masterclass and Band Director Bootcamp, programs that give passionate but overworked music teachers the tools they need to sustain their own mental and physical health while supporting their students' social and emotional needs in these challenging educational times. And she's written 2 best-selling books, I Love My Job But It's Killing Me and Love the Job, Lose the Stress. She's here with us today to help us figure out how to navigate the coming year, looking at what teachers need to be thinking about beyond the music. Lesley, thanks so much for joining us.
I'm really glad to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Well, it's our pleasure. We are talking about something really, really important today, and I can't wait to just get right into this. So tell us your story and how you became interested in what you do.
So we'll back this bus up before the pandemic. The almost 30 years or more than 30 years before that I had been teaching high school band, a job I absolutely adored that started out to be manageable and then over the years got busier and busier and more expectations and more activities. And then I had 3 children of my own and the program grew and it was very organic. But before I knew it, things really became out of hand. I was teaching that zero period class every morning and then working all day and then doing activities after school. And then in the evenings, we'd have a couple things each week, from fundraising events to meetings to performances. And it wore me out. I didn't have the time or the ability to make sure that I could stay healthy so that I could do the work that I was doing. And it was really taking a toll on me mentally and physically. And I was missing lots of school for various health reasons. And my doctors kept saying, it's just stress, Lesley. And I'm like, oh, just stress. And I started to realize, wait a minute, just stress is turning into all kinds of horrible things that required 14 different major surgeries, neck, back, and hip replacements, foot replacements. I was on a dozen pills a day for anxiety and depression and insomnia and pain and inflammation and ADHD. It was a toxic mess. And this was also, I could do this job and have, you know, go to sleep and then stay up. It was all being, you know, handled with pills and stuff because it got to be really hard. And so I started to think about the sustainability. How can I do this job I'm so passionate about if I'm too sick to be there, if I'm missing a month or 2 or 3 of school because I have surgeries? So I began this about four or five years ago when I got really sick and missed the last couple of months of school. I had to have a real hard look at, am I going to be able to continue doing this if I can't continue to serve my students when I can't even stay in the classroom, you know, without getting sick? So I made some major changes, major health changes. And a long story short is I've changed what I did. I had to look at the practices I was using that had gotten me to where I was and then undo that and say, what am I doing that's not helping me be healthy? And what am I modeling for my own children and my students through this process? And so I began to figure out how I was going to get healthier. And I did a lot of things that helped me get off all of my medications and help me not get rid of all of my symptoms, but manage them. And then I started to see the power in this. And I thought, oh my gosh, I am coming from a different place now. I was practicing skills that helped me de-stress and practicing being focused because I was coming off medication for ADHD and it was really hard. And I thought, these tools are super helpful for me. My anxiety levels are going down even though I'm coming off the pills. I thought, what if I could teach this technique to my students? And so I implemented this about five years ago, and started practicing a 4-minute routine with my students, and I saw the power it had for them and for me. And that became my obsession, was how can I share this with other teachers and other students so that, you know, we music teachers, we get all these kids that are high strung because they're so anxious about college and being, you know, in the AP classes and honor stuff, and they're working jobs and they're taking those hard classes and they're doing so many volunteer things. And so how do we help them cope with those and do that? And a big piece of what I did was help teach the tools I used in my own personal life, just as a musician, the skills I learned there, I teach to other to my students. I learned to teach this skill that has saved me, has kept me in the profession, to other teachers now and to their students. And you mentioned my books. That's what I got obsessed about it. And I started sharing it through books and sharing how people could get this in their own classroom. So before the pandemic, this was a focus. How do you keep as a music educator, your own social and emotional and physical health in a good place so you can model for your students? And why not teach them that along with the music? It makes it a lot easier.
Excellent. Yeah. And it really is something that we all need to keep in mind. I mean, we hear about stress all the time, but we don't realize what it can be doing to us and how we can really manage this and do this better. Okay. So let's talk about what this last year was like for you and your students. I mean, it was, of course, an unbelievably different kind of year. And yeah. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I really deviated from what almost every other high school music teacher did, at least band directors that I had talked to, and I've talked to lots of folks. But I surveyed my students the minute we went out on this emergency stuff in March of 2020. I sent out a survey to my students to find out everything from, like, do you have access to internet? Do you have does your school device work? Do you have an instrument available? And can you play your instrument during our band class time? Would you be able to take your saxophone out from 7:30 to 8:30 in the morning and practice it? I started gathering information from my students, and I quickly found out that, regular old ensemble stuff's not going to work when we're online. And as we started to see that there was a long, this was not just going to be a month or so, it was going to be for the long term, I realized I had to come up with a plan that was going to support the kids and serve them right now, right here in this moment, and continue to let them grow so that our music program and their skills would still be there, but it was not going to look the same. And so through surveys with kids, through trial and error and lots of things, what I ended up doing was coming up with a 6-week rotation, if you will, basically a 6-week goal setting plan. Because I thought, if I can teach my students to identify what they need to learn and teach them how to take steps to get to those goals, then even if they can't practice their instruments now, they'll get the goal setting habit to be such a habit that by the time we're back in the classroom, it'll work better. They'll be able to get those musical skills back in shape easily because they'll understand the power of that. So I took the school year, and every 6 weeks we would set a 6-week term goal. And then every time we met in class, we'd touch base with kids. I had them use band journals and we journaled what they were doing, what their goal was, and what step they would take each day. We broke things down into doable steps. And what that looked like is every 6 weeks they had one of two choices. They could come up with an independent music project, and I had ramifications for that, what it would look like learning the guitar. Well, you don't just learn the guitar, but maybe you'd learn in a 6-week period the names of the guitar strings and how to tune it and 4 chords or something. So they would come up with some goals, and then we'd break it down into the steps. And so they could take that one step on an independent music project was one track, or I was always doing one that I would have a directed activity. We did things like music theory. We studied Hamilton. We did a lot of other activities together. So I was always driving one of them. So if kids didn't want to be independent, they had me, or they had the other, their own independent project of their choices. And it was different than I had expected to do. But my whole goal before I started, I was like, my whole goal with my students, whether I'm in person or online, is I want them to feel peaceful in my presence so that they can express themselves as artists freely. And so whether that's playing their clarinet in my classroom or writing their own song, we hired a singer-songwriter to come in, and there was a songwriting project. And so kids used music and the arts in all kinds of new and innovative ways to express who they were. They discovered new talents. They explored other ones. And I saw sides of my students I would have missed if they were only playing second clarinet. Yeah, I'd have seen other stuff. And we all know that you still see cool stuff, but there was even more. And so it turned out that this, since we were online until the last 8 weeks of the school year, but we over a year online, this process worked really well. The kids grew as artists, grew as musicians. They could work independently, and they have the skill set now so that when we're back in the classroom, we can talk about what do you need to do to be ready musically? What do you need to do in the next 6 weeks? So what does that mean today? And it was a really great investment. And yeah, it was just so many things happened that I never could have dreamed of before.
Now that is amazing to hear. And I do want to mention that we did talk with Lesley, and we had a webinar back, it was probably April of 2020, I believe. You and I did a webinar, and we're going to link to it in the comments or in the description of this webinar or of this video. Sorry. So we talked about what the social emotional learning would be. You know, we were just at the beginning of the pandemic, and we just really didn't know what we were in for at that point. So it could be very interesting to go back and watch that. But that's why I was so interested in having you back now to answer this one question. What did we learn? What did you learn from that whole experience last year? And let's just go with that. What were your biggest takeaways from that?
Well, my first thing was, oh my God, I've taught for 32 years. I know how to be a band director, but I don't know how to do this online. So yeah. I thought, how do I do this? It's a whole different thing. I mean, band directors, music teachers, we walk in a classroom, we can see as the kids are coming in, we can read their body language, we see how they set up, we see what they do, we can hear what they're doing. There's this automatic feedback loop. Starting March 13th, screens, nothing. I mean, it was just, even the kids with the cameras on, it wasn't the same. And so I was like, oh, what are we going to do? So immediately what I did is I thought, I kept that goal in mind of wanting my kids to be peaceful in my presence so they could be authentically expressing themselves as musicians. How was I going to do that? So I looked back at how have I done this all these years? And this is my assistant
teacher.
Hi, Kitty. she helped us teach online band.
It's okay. Anyway, she's a part of it.
Yeah. I went back and I started thinking in a lot of depth about what have I done over the course of the 30,000 plus lessons that I've taught in the past 30 some years. What were some of the things that made it that really kind of, I guess, would be a template? I didn't create a template. I went back and looked at what I'd been doing, and then I drew out, here's what I almost always did when I was most successful. I had four components that I always addressed. A social piece. And these will be in the slides. You can actually see, I call it my mPowered music room, actually. You have to have something social for the students, a magnet that draws them in. And in our classroom, when kids come in the room, there are sounds and stuff associated with the band room. That's draw. In my classroom in person, I always have music playing over the PA as they're coming in. So it sets a tone. They can hear it as they're coming down the hall. It gets them in the zone. It gets them chatting with each other. And online, what did that look like? It looked like I created, or it still needed to be something to create. I wanted to create something that drew them in socially. So I created what I call You, Me, and a Cup of Tea, where each student was interviewed on a different day, and they got to share a little bit about themselves and a song that they really loved that helped get them out of the, you know, when they're having a hard day, that would lift them up. And we created a Quarantunes playlist of all of those anthems. So we had a social piece. And then a focus piece. I looked at the four components and I realized in my most successful classes, I always took time to help students focus first, not dive in and teach the content. But once I've brought them together, got them excited about being there, what do I do to help them focus? So I continued that piece online as well. And then that third piece is the content. And I had to really look at content. I can't teach. I don't know how to teach online band and rehearse and help them all online on Zoom. It's not possible. So I had to create content that would address, you know, I look to the national standards at NAFME. First thing, what am I charged with teaching? Let me remember what those things are, and let me find new ways to teach those things. And so that content is about 75% of what you do. And then I also realized that in class, in our music classes, we always have this automatic feedback loop. We can respond in person. We can do all this. Not so much the case in an online setting. So I created something I called the Moffagram. I said to my students, you know, when I see you in class, I can talk to you, I can hear from you, I get to hear your voice every day or see you. I need to do that when we're online too. I need your feedback, and y'all have the Instagrams and stuff. So I created the Moffagram, and every single day at the end of class, I put that link in our chat box, and they all did it online, and it like, who are you, what grade are you in, what class? And then it had sometimes just one question. Other times I would use it for, you know, a whole bunch of things, because I trained them that every day there'd be a Moffagram, and that became our loop. And I had 95.5% return rate on every single Moffagram across the board, 9th through 12th grade this year. They wanted their voices heard, and I used the information I got off of there then to help me be a better teacher for the next lessons, assess where they were, know if I needed to reach out to a student before the next class, adjust my lessons. So I learned that we can, if we look at what is our goal, what are we charged with teaching, and we have a weird circumstance, we can find the activity, you know, we can find ways to teach those things in new and innovative ways. But for me, it became real easy when I had this template, if you will. It would be like chord changes for a jazz musician. If you know you're going to be playing a blues, you might be playing it in F today, next time you do it and it's in G, maybe you're playing piano on it one time and you're jamming on trombone the next time. It doesn't matter what you're doing. You can adapt because you have a flow that goes. And mm-hmm. So by continuing to use that flow with my students, there was a familiarity. Boy, is that important with kids. Yeah. They were used to some of those same things in my classroom, and it flowed easier. When we go back in person next year, they'll still have music playing when they come in the classroom. We'll still do that same mindfulness routine. I'll still do the Moffagram at the end to get feedback. So there will be familiarity. There's continuity. Rituals are important. All of those things were reaffirmed with this class. And my big worry was, well, do you think this, you know, no, there's no research to tell me, was this the right choice? And maybe the Moffagrams, at the end of the year, my final Moffagram, I asked my students, how satisfied are you with your band class experience this year? And as you can see from that slide, when I've got, you know, what, 33% extremely satisfied and 45% very satisfied, that's pretty darn good, I would think. Considering our situation. Great. So I feel, and plus, the other, 29, so almost everybody was satisfied or above. And in this situation, that was important to see. This gave me the feedback on, did I do the right thing in this situation? Was it, you know, all of us as music teachers had to find out what's right for our kids. That's what we're so good at. What do mm-hmm. our kids need in our circumstances? What I did might not have worked for anybody or everybody else. But the piece that was important is looking at what my students needed, what my community, you know, needs, and then how do I adapt? And then the takeaways we get from the things we learned, I think, are pretty make music ed 2.0. I'll take it a step further. Like I've been saying, ready or not, here we grow. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. We know how powerful ensembles are, everything that they bring. And we now know how much more we can bring to the table with the use of technology that we all had to become more fluent in. Not by choice. I was still writing stuff by hand, music notes and everything faster prior to the pandemic, but I'm a whiz now on the music writing software. Never would have done that if I didn't need to do it to serve my students. And then I asked my kids if what we did, goal setting, was helpful. And when I look at that slide that shows me, almost all of them are saying it was very helpful, you know, they've learned this process that they can now apply back in the classroom. So it was time well spent.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. So we are, can you just really quick talk about the four-step process or the mPowered Music Room one more time, just to kind of walk us through that template, just so everybody really understands what we're talking about. And anybody can use this in your classroom, regardless of what you teach.
Yeah. So if you look at that template, we teach those soft skills normally, or the social skills are an inherent part of what we do. But I put about 10% of my planning time that I spend on what am I going to do for that social piece. So what do you as a teacher do to help your kids be drawn into the space? And how do you differentiate the band room from the math classroom when they walk in? Do they hear things different? Do they get excited just by the sights and sounds of your space? That's important. And again, when we were online, I created this, the You, Me, and a Cup of Tea as a way to highlight each student each day. because we needed to do something and they needed to get to know their peers. Mm-hmm. So I had a set of questions I would ask them. They had all had to prepare a slide ahead of time and all of that. So intentionally putting our time and attention on how we're going to meet our students' social needs. So that, because that's the draw. Kids don't get super excited about the social part often of maybe a social studies class as much as they can here. And they need that. That's part of their development. That second piece that I talked about is focus. So what do you do to help your students focus? You may already have something that works great for you. I have clients who teach elementary school who do a lot of physical movement, big movements, and then they make them smaller to help the students take all that energy and bring it in. I do different things at the high school level. All of us can do our own different things. I have an example that I'll leave a slide here at the end of my first 4-minute template. It's just the relaxation that I talk my students through every day to help them focus, to help them do that. But we all need to do something to help our students close all those tabs that are open in their head when they walk in the door, right? Help them de-escalate, help them get all on the same page, get warmed up, if you will, and focus like we do with our instruments. Then about 75% of your planning and your time in the actual teaching time is spent on your content, right? Not this 100% content. No, kids don't care about what you know until you've gotten, you know, pulled them in and gotten their attention. The why should I be doing this? Then delivering a really high quality lesson. And then in the classroom, I know every teacher who's out there watching this, all of you who've done ensembles for a few years before the pandemic, you know how to do those things. How are you going to adapt what you've learned and, you know, carefully plan that? But that's going to be the biggest chunk of your instructional time there. But then that last little bit is about 5% of your class time at the most, but that coda piece, that wrap up at the end that says, what have I done? I can go back for every single student and I can tell you for every single time we had class, how they responded to those Moffagrams, because they all turned them in and we can track each kid. What was, you know, if a kid missed more than 2 or 3, they were hearing from me, like, what's happened? Did you drop off the radar? Blah, blah, blah. So that I'm going to continue in my classroom and I'll use it a little differently. Might say, you know, today in class, what did you learn and what do you need to practice before tomorrow? Or what is something new? So I'll use that Moffagram as a way for the kids to reflect and for them to give me that information. Mm-hmm. Super helpful when you sit down with a student or parents. And they're like, oh, I'm really confused or lost. You can say, let's look at your Moffagrams. And when did that pattern start? And all of that. It's super helpful. And it's, So those are those 4 pieces. And each day, a social piece, I just have to, which song am I going to use today for the kids coming in? I always know what I'm going to do for the focus piece. And then I just change up the coda, that Moffagram question of the day. So those pieces are really in place already. Now you see how easy my planning is. What's my lesson going to be? Easy to figure out my lesson because I look at yesterday's Moffagram. What was my feedback? Where's the learning gaps? What do I need to cover? My life became so much easier when I just went, why didn't I do this before?
Well, and it also connects you to those students on a deeper level. I mean, you're getting, it sounds like, you know, I've heard of teachers using exit slips, you know, on their way
it's
out.
It's the same thing as an exit ticket. I just wanted to sound cooler.
Yeah, well, everybody can and call it their own thing.
Yeah, and it's just a Google form, you guys. So the cool part is, as you can see from some of the things I shared you, some of the slides that I just put some samples, it gathers the data. And when it's live, as opposed to these are screenshots that I put in there, when I'm in Google itself, it'll actually pull up the actual numbers and I can see which kids responded which ways. Mm-hmm. I can sort my spreadsheets super fast so that I can identify learning needs. It was the most important thing I did. Here's the trick. Before I used it for anything major, I trained the kids to use it as a tool every day. Why is this important? And I would ask them, you know, it's pretty low key, one question a day besides their name and student ID number and class period. One question. So it was super easy at first. It'd take them no time at all. And I'd immediately that afternoon have 10 points in the grade book. And it didn't matter what they answered in the Moffagram. It was, did you turn it in? Mm-hmm. And those points just became for the kids and for me as a way to track, am I communicating? I said, that's just our communication recognition. Are we communicating? And anyway, so that tool, it just became so, so helpful. The graphs that I hated data. Oh my God, I used to sit in staff meetings and want to poke my eyes out with a pitchfork. Somebody would go, look at the charts and data. And I'd be like, no, make it stop. And then I started using these and I'm like, I'm a better teacher now. We music teachers get data all the time. Oh, that wasn't an F sharp. Or, oh, it should be in this key. We use data. It just looks different in the classroom.
Yeah.
So I had to learn how to take data that could help me teach and gather it in a way that was helpful for the students and me. So essentially, since I couldn't use my ears and teach the way I would, ears and eyes in a normal way, I had to turn to Google Forms for the answer. super, super helpful. I cannot imagine not using this anymore with my kids.
And I think this is one thing you can absolutely keep using, and I'm sure you will. I mean, everybody still, now that we have these online platforms that kids are used to using, having them just do this online, either on their phone or their tablet, I mean, whatever they have, piece of cake. You're going to have all this data forever.
Yes.
It's great. All right. Well, let's move on. Let's talk about this coming year then. So with all of this that you've learned, and you've already alluded to some of this, what are you planning to do differently now that you're going to have a live in-person class again? And can you share some ideas with the rest of us?
I'll do a lot the same. I will continue to have, like I told you there, but different than pre-pandemic. There will be more opportunities for my students to explore beyond replicating or reproducing music that's been written as according to a rubric and all. You know, we got so, I have my kids listen to the recordings. Let's emulate this, because that is a part of learning. I mean, I think as Dizzy Gillespie said, there are three parts, it's, you know, musicians. First we imitate, then we assimilate, and then we innovate. And so we, I think our kids have done a lot of the first two, but not so much of the innovation, except in the jazz programs. They get to do that more in jazz programs. Mm-hmm. That's not fair. That we're not serving our biggest numbers of students with innovation. And that's where the creativity comes. So what if a student says to me, hey, for solo ensemble, I want to take this piece of music and arrange it for this quintet with my friends and me so we can do this? I would have said, oh gosh, you know, I don't know. I'm gonna say, heck yes. Yes. They've learned. That's telling me they're gonna do all kinds of things beyond just playing a part somebody else wrote out for them. And so that kind of thing, bringing more technology in where it's helpful and useful, more opportunities for our kids to expand beyond just our classroom without having to actually go on field trips. We brought in some different folks, like a Disney arranger got to come and talk to us. Like I said, we had Emma G did our songwriting workshops, bringing in these people that are writing music for our students so they can actually talk to them, or different people who, you know, experts on different instruments, or not being shying away from saying to a student, you're struggling with that, why don't you go into a practice room, go ahead and use other resources, pull up YouTube, somebody on there probably knows more than I do about how to play guitar, because I'm not a guitar player, right? I've taught my students how to discern, not completely, but how to better discern you know, things they're looking for if they are on YouTube looking for things. And so teaching my students how to learn things that are interesting to them. So if they want to explore more composition, allowing space for that, instead of saying, oh, we have a concert and we're going to be great at how well you play your third clarinet part. You want to explore composition or arranging? How can I support you? That's going to be hard in some cases, you know, because there will still be some expectations when we go back. Well, what about this? And what about that? You always did this. Well, I surveyed my kids in that final Moffagram. You know, what is, you know, breaking kids back into full-time school next year after what they've been through, we need to be super careful about how do we build this back in? What are the activities we're adding and doing that support the kids in their growth without burning them out? And so I'm not doing a fall concert next year. We're waiting till December so we can have the time to develop our community again before we dive right in to get ready for a concert. I'm going to intentionally make sure we build that time in.
Can you
Did
say
I just
more
totally wander off whatever you talked
no,
about?
No. That was good. That was good. Say more about kind of how you're planning to develop that community back in the fall. I love the idea of not having a full concert right away because you can't just jump into where you were. But what are some things that you think you're going to do this fall to build that community back?
I asked my students what they wanted to do. Some of them wanted, you know, well, retreats have always been a big part of what we've done. So, you know, we may not be able to do overnight. I don't know, but we'll do some kind of that kind of activity. I surveyed them and I asked which different things. We'll have a music diversity committee of folks that really want to work together on that piece and getting to know that better. Folks that want to have some extra activities that they might be involved in with the leadership. I asked specifically in my thing, would you be interested in being a leader next year? And the students said yes, or maybe, or not yet were the three options. So the yes and maybes, I collect, you know, I've got them. So I'm going to be reaching out to them this month saying, hey, let's get together and let's talk about next year. Student voice, student voice, student voice. They don't get to decide how things go, but their input is critical and I have to listen to them. And then I have the responsibility for taking what they want, and how do I, you know, then also make sure they're growing as musicians and artists. But they are my best source of how to set up this school year.
So just so what it sounds like is just really getting to know them and where they're at, and maybe just asking them that right at the beginning 100%. Of the year, like, or over the summer, like, where are you at with this? You know, how are you feeling about being back at school? How do you feel about playing in an ensemble right now? Are you a little, are you nervous about this, or are you totally gung-ho?
I actually asked that on the end of the year survey for my Moffat Gram. These are just sample questions, but the last one was quite a bit longer. One of them was, you know, because we got to play the last for graduation. I had 2 1-hour rehearsals with the kids 9 feet apart with masks and all that stuff on, and we had to play outside. But then I said, how did it feel to play as in an ensemble again, you know, to get them thinking about this was so fun and get them all set up for that. And then I asked them, you know, what are you looking most forward to next year in band, you know, playing my instrument, social piece, and trying to find out. So I've already asked that information of all of the kids. So when I pull those kids that want to be leaders together, we've got that data of all my incoming kids.
Excellent.
So yeah, because it takes time for me to think about now, okay, here's where they're coming from, and how do I then, I know a lot of times it's easy to default on, let me plan the activities first, all the stuff we'll do, and then I'll think about what I want them to know and learn. Mm-mm. What's my goal? What do I want them to learn? And then I'm finding the activities that work for that. And so we'll probably have several pizza parties with my leadership. You know why? You feed them, they'll show up, and then they start talking. You can kick back and just have some conversations, not formal meetings, but those kind of like, hey, let's all sit around a campfire and have some conversations. That's how you build that community. And if I say to them after the first one, could each of you maybe bring one person back with you next time? Wouldn't it be fun to double this? They could each ask one person, right? Mm-hmm. So if I have 10 kids show up, and then it turns into 20, and then each of them, can you make sure at the first event that we have that you reach out to 3 people and introduce yourself? And each, yeah, I mean, we just build community like that the same way I would do if I had an incoming class of freshmen. This time it's like a huge group of freshmen, you know, all these new kids to the school are leaders, are kids that normally are going to be, would be leaders. A lot of them haven't been in the building for a year and a half. They were sophomores last time they were there, and now they're going to be seniors. What? They don't. Yeah, exactly. They didn't get to watch. They didn't get to see people model this. So I have to teach that. We have to talk about what that looks like. We music educators have to have a vision of what we want. Get it, come up with that with our students, because if we don't, we'll get whatever happens. But if we can be crystal clear on, we want to support our kids in certain ways, and we want to have this social piece, we want to, for me, one of the most important pieces is the community feeling, a feeling of family. Part of that is my dad was my high school band director. His mom was an orchestra teacher. My 3 children were part of my program for 12 consecutive years. I live in the community I serve, and I was going to retire in June of 2020, but I stayed on because I felt so passionate about supporting teachers and students with the social and emotional needs that we all have after the traumas that so many people have dealt with and all of this. So yeah, this gets me fired up. This gets me excited. And I think the possibilities are amazing. Amazing. Even though this has been really, really hard and it's going to take a lot to rebuild, I think we have vision, and if we know how to talk to our communities and our administrators and our students, they'll see the value in having these places where our students are healing, where they're going out back into our schools and community and bringing that feeling of community to the groups, or to everyone else at large. We serve a big part in the healing for so much of beyond just our own students in the classroom. So so much potential if we do this right.
And this is a perfect time to be talking about this, because teachers really do need to think about how this year will be different, and you can't just jump into where you left off back in whenever that was, March of 2020. I mean, the idea of just not emphasizing the performance immediately, you know, like really just sort of easing into the whole routine again. I really like that. I like that a lot. Let's move on. So if people are interested in, and perhaps teachers themselves are feeling the stress of having to go back and the stress of this whole year, and let's talk about your books, because your books, especially the first one, do a great job of really giving us some tools to think about managing the stress and what it brings. So these are both in stock at JW Pepper right now. So if you want to get them, there will be links down in the description below. But Lesley, tell us about these books, and we're going to put a slide up here that gives some information too.
So my first book is called I Love My Job, But It's Killing Me. And it was a teacher's guide to conquering chronic stress and sickness. And it was based on my own struggle with my own health. And, you know, what's interesting is I thought I had this really unique story. And as I've gone on the speaking circuits and done all these classes and all these different things, I'm finding out that, no, this isn't a very unique story at all. We have music teachers all over the planet. Oh my God. I long for the day when people look at my book and they go, don't need that. But this was that first book is, you know, where do you even start when you feel like crap and everything's overwhelming and you've got three kids and you've got, you know, all of those things going, how do you get it all together? So what I did is I looked at how did I make the changes? What did I go through? And that book is going back and what were the assessments I did to find out where were the biggest problem areas in my life? What was causing me the most physical, emotional, mental problems? And then biting off one piece at a time. But I had to, so I've got assessments in there, you know, for people to go through, a music teacher mojo meter to go through and different things you can do to assess yourself. And there's some weird questions in there that might not seem relevant, but when you start to break down in the book, it starts to tell you if these things are going on, here's what some of the things might be going in, or that you could change or look at some habits that you might have or and the like. I learned some skills that really hard but powerful from my mentors, boundary setting. I talk mm-hmm. a lot about that mm-hmm. because that's critical and it helps you be a better teacher. You serve your students better once you get over the fear of setting boundaries. But can you imagine if we didn't have boundaries on the freeway, if there were no lines or anything, and it would be scary. And it's also scary for students if we don't have boundaries and scary for us. So anyway, it's that first book is about assessing your own, you know, kind of getting your own self together. You know, how do you do it? How do you talk to administrators about the hard stuff? How do you do all of these things? And why is it so important? I think we music educators, I've said this before, I'm going to say it till the day I die. We have such a unique opportunity because we get students for 3, 4, 5, 6 years at a time or in a row. So we can see them grow more than almost any other adult in their life, other than family. Even coaches only see them, you know, the season and stuff. We really get to see them. So our role in their lives, I think, is really important. We can nurture a real important part of their growth, and we need the stamina to do it. So my first book is how do you get that stamina so you don't have to. I thought about quitting because in my like 27th year or whatever, because it was getting so physically and emotionally exhausting. Then I was ready to retire right before the pandemic, but on a whole different level, right? So I started writing my book in January of 2020, Love the Job, Lose the Stress. I'm like, I've got 90 days to write my book. I'll write this. It'll be right as I go out and I'll do my Carnegie Hall concert in May and then I'll retire in June. And this was all the stuff I'd learned, what had led me to not stress-free teaching, but a lot less stress and a much healthier me. Finished the manuscript March 3rd, 2020. 10 days later, the universe said, really, love the job, lose the stress. Let's test that, Lesley. And it did. It put to the test everything I wrote. I was like, oh my God, this won't even be relevant after a pandemic. And I was really afraid. And I thought, I got to change the title. Congratulations, you've got a publisher. Went, oh crap, I can't change the title. And so I felt a little foolish until I really, at the end of the school year, I look back and I go, now, wow. Everything in there is still relevant. I mm-hmm. applied everything I wrote there. Mm-hmm. I didn't lose the stress, but the stress didn't take me over. This would have killed me earlier in my teaching career. This would have done me in, and I would have just been dragging it to the finish line. I didn't feel that way this year. The habits I practiced to get healthy became habits, so that in spite of how awful and scary and overwhelming everything was, I was able to do this. It's like if you properly prepare for a performance. If you practice until you can't get it wrong, so that you are totally, you know it, so that even if the, you know, lights go out or your music flies off your stand or whatever, even if you don't think you have it memorized, that muscle memory takes over the decisions you make. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing here, training myself to eat the healthy meals, to make sure I do some yoga every day, to walk every day, to do the things that keep me in the space so that I'm a fresher, better teacher. And it's easier. Mm-hmm. So those are the two books. And the second book really is all the tools that I learned personally in that first book. How do you take them into your classroom? And mm-hmm. why is that important to teach your students some of those same things? And how does that impact them individually and the collective? And those Moffagrams, and I've got tons of data and research now, kids' own words about the power of what we've done and how it helped them through the pandemic. And I also had surveys from my time before the pandemic. And I'm just really grateful that I had the opportunity to write that book, because I think teachers right now are going to need some strategies, and our students are going to need them in right place at the right time. There's a reason I went through all that now, because my whole goal had been I wanted to share what I learned so that in the future, people that had dealt with trauma or, you know, anxiety and all those things could have better music classroom experiences. Here we are. I get to do that now.
So in addition to those two books, you're also offering us some free resources, and we're going to put that slide up here right now. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what these are?
The first one I've got up there is my first 4-minute routine that I do with my students, my mindfulness, if you will, whatever you want to call it, essentially a guided breathing routine. I created a template for that. Literally, here's my script that I say, here's why I say it, what the purpose of it is, and here's what you would maybe, and then I leave blanks for you to write your own script in your own words. So if that's a helpful way for somebody who doesn't already have a routine that they use or is looking for some other ideas, they can go to that and download it and see, oh, here's what I could, how they can just use it and make it their own. Mm-hmm. So there's that. It's at thefirst4minutes.com. I also have an audio recording of me doing a mindfulness. It's like 10 minutes long, just that breathing routine for music teachers who want a 10-minute, like, oh, I just need a break. And it's similar to what I do with my students in class, just a little more extended to give music educators a chance for that moment. And so I put a link to that from my website. And then the third one is my Moffitgram template that anybody could link to, just to see. Literally, that's the part I copied every day. And then I would add one question, or I started just using it for everything. Mm-hmm. Instead of doing an assignment in Canvas, I would put the Moffitgram link in Canvas on our async days. So everything was still stored in the Moffitgram thing. So this is, it's a great tool. Google Forms are free, easy to use, and super helpful. Admin loves it because I can show student growth.
Exactly.
I can show participation. My numbers are there that say, you had over 95% every day. They can see how many kids are responding. They can see all that. So it's not me just making stuff up. You can track stuff, and it makes your job as a teacher so much easier. The students loved it. I mean, I read the comments, and they really liked that accountability. It helped them. Tools that were helpful. So I offer them.
Thank you so much. And I know people are going to love that. If they have additional questions for you or want to perhaps bring you into their school or talk to their group, what's the best way for them to contact you?
They can reach out to me at Lesley, L-E-S-L-E-Y, at mpowerededucator.com, letter M, powerededucator.com.
Do you have any parting thoughts for our viewers today?
I would encourage you to be really mindful of how you approach your next school year. And it's easy to say, don't be thinking recruitment, you know, way, way down the line, but make sure you're serving your students and yourself in the moment. Are you staying healthy enough and taking care of your own social and emotional and physical health so that you'll have the stamina to do this important work? Because we've got really important work to do when we go back, and kids are counting on us. So make sure you're taking care of yourself in the same way you would take care of other people. Or if you were going to perform on your instrument, on a piano, play Rhapsody in Blue on the piano for a performance, you'd make sure it was in tune. You would take care of the piano. You would do the practicing. Care for yourself in the same way so that you are at your prime. When you're feeling good, everything else comes so much easier. And I know people want to vomit when they hear the word self-care. I don't have time for that, or what, you know, it is important. It's just like saying, you know, if you had a broken reed and you were trying to play a clarinet concerto, you can only do so much if that reed's in bad shape. If you don't take care of the tools you have, and our tools are our brains and our bodies, everything else is harder.
Amen. I fully agree with everything you just said. So much. It's something that we should all think of, regardless of what our job is. You know, we really do need to take care of ourselves. So, Lesley, this has been just a treat talking to you again. I'm really glad we did this kind of follow up to our last webinar, because you are absolutely right. Everything that you told us back in April of last year, absolutely, completely still relevant, if not even more important now. So thank you so much. And I know everybody is going to appreciate these resources, and hopefully they'll want to log in and pick up copies of your book and read them before the school year starts, because honestly, we've got time to do that now. So they're quick reads. I really encourage everyone to take a look. So thank you so much, Lesley, and we will, I'm sure, visit with you again soon.
Well, I hope so. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for joining us for this podcast. We hope you found this discussion helpful. We know that this year is going to be full of challenges, and we're trying to help you navigate them the best you can. If you did find this video helpful, give us a thumbs up. And be sure to comment below to let us know of any ideas you want to see in future episodes. And don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any new content we have coming out at JW Pepper. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.